Professor Keshab Das is the next speaker on inclusive innovation in rural craft clusters. Keshab.
I must thank Professor Baldev Raj for giving this very significant opportunity, and it's a distinguished gathering of scientists and people from engineering and technical background, but I belong to social sciences, but my sort of concern has been with reference to certain kinds of activities in rural areas, which I do not know that you call them as manufacturing in the modern sense, but then they have been there for a long, long time. I'm referring to the artisanal form of production in rural India. When we're talking about issues in inclusive manufacturing, issues in inclusive innovation, I think somewhere we need to recognize that this is not just artifact-centric concern that you have. Actually, all the activities that takes form in larger innovation systems, and there are other institutions, other actors who also influence. So long as you are not addressing those concerns, you may not be achieving very much in terms of only through an artifact-centric change. And we are sort of also referring to the fact that when you're talking of inclusive inclusion as an issue, maybe there are sort of issues in exclusion which we must address first. That will be a better way to address issues in inclusion. And we are referring to the broad context is a very large number of crafts in this country, and there have been sort of they account for this is the major source of non-farm activity, given that agriculture is not doing very well. And there are a large number of clusters, in fact, there's more than 6,400 clusters in this country, and of which 6,000 clusters are sort of like 3,000 of them handlooms and 3,000 are handicraft clusters, and very large presence, they're sort of there everywhere. But there's also a growing concern that many of these crafts, artisan-based activities have been on the decline, and so and there is also the issue of access to markets, issue of access to institutional support, and a variety of other crises that I'll be talking very soon. Sort of like very broadly, kind of to have some kind of idea about what kind of sort of exclusion they face, and sort of four broad categories are spatial, challenged by geography. I need not read them out. The sectoral, sort of you're working in a particular sector, or you're having a certain product which is no longer in demand, or the raw material is no longer available, or there's sort of institutional or systemic sort of crisis, maybe you belong to informal sector, which is actually the case as what I was mentioning yesterday. Informality predominates this activity, so with that, a lot of exclusion takes place. And of course, there are certain craft activities which are sort of seasonal in nature, sort of can be done during a certain, linked to a certain maybe agricultural season, or sort of linked to certain kinds of festivals. So there is a very limited demand for certain products. So these are the sort of special sort of crisis they face in terms of exclusion. And also historically, I mean, if you see the policies, government policies, we have been actually neglecting the craft sector or the rural industry sector for a long, long time, despite all our lip service to this sector, and despite several ministries that you have, the MSEs, that is the micro and small enterprises, which sort of would constitute more than 95% of the number of units, they have been sort of sidelined. And I'll just very quickly, this is not the time to give all the details, but very quickly, this is the post-90s scene when there has been one of the most classic constraint faced by this sector is sort of finance, working capital, and both have been on the decline, whether they are sort of MSEs, that micro small enterprises, or the village industries within that, the decline is absolutely palpable. And there is another form of exclusion, that is the statistical exclusion. We know nothing about this sector, how many crafts are there, how many craftspersons are there, how many are involved in the pre and the post production systems. And as we know that in this last 70 years of our independence, only once we have done a census of crafts, that was in 1995. We do not have any information. There have been an attempt made by the Crafts Council of India in Chennai. It's a kind of a private body. And they sort of, these are the kind of, I'm just showing the broad sort of figures, showing how distinctly different they are from. So we do not know which one is, which red figure is actually the correct one. And also, you know that even the economic census 2012, whose information has just come in, there was only one single question asked to identify whether you are a craft person. So it simply shows that the huge statistical explanation, I'm part of the small team who are working for sort of developing prototypes for better data collection on this. So, and these are also sort of many such schemes, and these are some of the most recent ones. And we know very little about them, and we know that they were sort of meant for creating common facility centers and providing certain kind of support, but then we know that the reach has been very, very limited. I go to three quick sort of clusters, artisan clusters, and I've done several of them in the country, and this is sort of one in Rajasthan, sort of terracotta cluster, and it's very well known. It has got the GI certification, et cetera, et cetera. But then, this is something which has been there for a long time, sort of mostly using local resources, the local clay, local techniques of making things. And this is brittle by nature. So this is the kind of product that we are talking about having a fairly local demand. This is the product that I'm referring to. And what kind of product and process innovation that you can do that this product has a wider market. So maybe very minor changes, maybe instead of the chula, maybe you can sort of use a little fan somewhere, you may put a little color varnish on something, but beyond that, we have done very little on this. So we have done practically nothing. I mean, this is applicable to most of the craft products that in terms of packaging and in terms of sort of making arrangement for the marketing. So this is the kind of craft that I'm referring to. That is the raw material, that is the technology, if you like, and this is the innovation maximum you can think of. So when you're dealing with this kind of products and you have a GI, the state is very much in support of this. So we go to the field, and maybe after 3 months of this event, which the GI, there was a meeting, and the craft persons were sort of talked about this, and you find these documents thrown in the ukadas or the public dustbins in the village. So the villagers knew nothing about what to do with the GIs. And so there is no market support. So these are also, this is very close to the Srinath Ji temple. So this is sort of very low priced and sort of sold on the roadside. So this is how we have been dealing with our sector. And then there is a huge external crisis. That is, the entire thing is based on local clay. And this is actually the area, the Haldighat area. And this is where now some of the major real estate guys have come in. So they have more or less taken over the entire land base. And so the craft persons are there, the skill is there, but the raw material is lost. We come to the next one in Barpeta, in Assam. This is also an old cluster, and yesterday also someone was mentioning. This bamboo cluster has received some support from the state, the NEHSDC. But as you can see that the wages are extremely low, so there is very little incentive for the next generation to actually to get engaged in this, but excellent products, as you can see, sort of using the most basic primary tools. Very unlike the earlier cluster, there is a huge supply of the raw material, the bamboo. They are in a great supply, and you have the under the Spurti program, you have the common facility center, and hardly anyone goes there because they are only used to the implements that you see there, and there is very little training happening on record. Yes, there is a scheme, but maybe they are not very relevant. We come to Karnataka, to Athani near Belgaum. This is a small town, or kind of small, you can say village town, in fact. So which is sort of having a long history in sort of making Kolhapuri chappals. And there have been a lot of efforts made by a certain NGO from Bangalore, who connected these craft persons to the global market. And sort of there was a huge sort of investment in innovation and mechanization, and that seemed to have done very well. And this is a kind of a cluster map, if I'm so sure. All the sort of stakeholders who are involved, that includes CSIR, CLRI, KBIC, the local tanners, the small, so everybody is involved. So that is all that you have. But then, but you have a situation where many of these institutions are no longer functioning, they are no longer relevant, and even if the local NGO who was sort of involved in this, there was also a sort of development of mistrust in terms of what kind of prices they were getting from the global market. So there are sort of crises relating to this. And so this is the kind of cluster that I'm referring to. That's the tanning process. And this is how our artisans are working. And but then very fantastic, these are the same Kolhapuri skilled workers, more than 600 designs sort of sent all across the globe, in fact. And so that is the sort of capability they have, and this is largely handwork. And this is the CLRI sort of unit, and that is the Khadi Gramodyog, this board was thrown somewhere. And the CLRI unit, which I happened to visit and inquire, there is a common facility center, but that is entirely made for making boots. And it has got nothing to do with the Kolhapuri Chapal, the officer who was in charge, maybe, I don't know, some 3 decades back, sort of brought in all the machineries, all the things. So no one ever goes there. So there is a central government CLRI office standing in the middle of the cluster of no use to anyone. And this is the sort of private initiative made by the local NGO. So they brought in certain machineries from abroad. But then, as I did mention, that there was sort of a trust deficit, and that did not quite work. So what kind of, so when we're talking about the entire rural clusters, rural crafts, rural industries, so it is not just a question of sort of artifact innovations, but actually what kind of constraints we are facing. Is it something to do with the methods of doing it, the materials, the applications, or it's a larger question of very weak market institution and infrastructure related issues, and or we have sort of accepted the way we have seen these crafts for a long, long time, despite all our praise for the skills and the crafts. Maybe we always have thought them, taken them as poor people. So it is essentially some poor people having some little skill. So it has been sort of dealt as a livelihood-centric kind of a activity. And that's where I think we need to have a rethink how to make it a much more sort of profitable, much more productive, and something which will have incentive for the next generation to get engaged. And just see how the other countries, like just the Asian countries, I'm referring to countries in Japan and countries like Japan, Thailand, Malaysia, Philippines, China, and even of late several African countries, how they are sort of, this is just a one village, one product idea, which originally came from the Oita Prefecture in Japan, but then later picked up and sort of did in, done in different way, the one Tambon, one product idea for the Thailand government. And there's a lot of new stakeholders, new ideas, new incentives, engaging students for collecting data, engaging the Thai Airways for promoting your products, engaging the Thai embassy, for instance, and a lot of incentive systems which were introduced. So there is a pride involved in making this, and also there is an excellent support in not just sort of supporting in terms of providing raw materials, etc., but also linking them to wider markets, which we rarely do. And as far as the data is concerned, this is something which I have done in an institute in Japan for a long time. And so this is something I sort of thought of creating, what kind of database we have. And so I created a kind of a, what I call as a cluster grid. It's kind of a database, interactive online database system, which sort of like has a unique identification number for each cluster. And you can divide it by sector, space, and support systems. And sort of then, once you know, you identify what, so it is by cluster, you identify all these sort of issues in that, and then you can think in terms of the intervention, like whether it's a question of raw material, or it's a question of finance, or there's a question of markets, there's a question of technology, and whatever it is, so maybe one can, and this being an interactive database, it should be of greater, which is very, very different from the kind of usual NSS data that we have, or as I said, that we only had one round of survey in 1995. And see how differently other countries, particularly the East Asian, with the East Asian countries, they're seeing it very differently. They're sort of trying to see this as culture to creative industries, thinking in terms of sort of linking culture and finding a way between culture and commerce. I think we need to think whether the ICT can play a major role in promoting this craft. So these are the sort of new thinking which is really needed, and knowledge inputs, not just in terms of how to make a thing, but also how to sell it, what kind of financial knowledge we have. So we need entrepreneurial education. We sort of, they must know how to conduct small business and how to also look for larger markets. This is the last one. So we have to really classify crafts before, if you want to think of inclusive manufacturing or inclusive production systems, then we have to first figure out which are the constraints, whether it's a resource centric constraint, it's a market centric or it's an institution centric constraint. Otherwise, we still have what I call as this huge craft sector. I call it as the subsistence industrialization syndrome. Thank you very much.